need to keep on throughout the year. Praise God, because he's been so wonderful to us, and he's done wonderful things with our lives. So, I encourage the church to keep celebrating. And this morning, let's talk about great gratuity. Now this word, you know, when you go to a restaurant, you sit down and eat, and you're done, get the bill, see what they've charged, and then you add something. You have tax and something for the worker who brought you the food. And it's called a tip. You pay for the food, and you pay them a tip. God's gift of love is not, his gift of love was not enough. He also had to send his son to die on the cross for us. And so his gift, we receive just like we give money to the restaurant workers who work so hard. And so we give them some extra money. Also, the same concept is what God gave us. So this morning, let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you. Ask you to bless us here, Lord. Please lead us as we think about how great a gratuity you've given us. You've given us a free gift, the great gift of your Son, your only Son, who came to earth to be born. Beautiful Lord, as an infant, and our Savior, and the light of the world. He is the truth. He is the way. He has the gift of life. And we honor and worship him as he guides us and rules the world. We see him as our King. We thank you morning. I pray that we will think about and let our hearts and minds be open to communing with you about your gift to us, blessings and happiness and peace and joy and contentment. A wonderful spiritual gift at Christmas. And we keep going throughout the new year. Look forward to the coming great gift. So please give us peace, give us happiness on earth, and help us to be strong and take a spiritual stand through the darkness. Help our lights to shine and change people. We come to worship and honor you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I'd like to sing a little bit of a solo so you can just watch me sing. So, this matches the symbolism that we have here with the manger. And Christmas tree. So think about that as we sing, as I sing, and I'll sign this song. The manger, where he lay in the hay, the little Lord Jesus asleep. He laid down his sweet head. The stars in the sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. Look down with love, Jesus. The stars look down. Stay with me, Lord Jesus, I ask thee to stay. Close by me. Forever. And love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care. And take us to heaven to live with thee there. Amen. So, away in a manger. Jesus and the stars looking down on Jesus as he lay. That's the title of the song. So now let's talk about the great gift or gratuity. The great gift. What is this great gift that we're talking about? It's God sending his son, his only begotten son, who came to earth as a small baby to seek and to save the lost. Those who are lost in darkness and sin and illness and suffering are searching for a hope. Jesus came to earth to give them freedom and salvation, to save people who were lost. So God sent his son to earth. And that was a Christmas gift. We celebrate Christmas as the gift of God's Son, Jesus Christ, to us. So we thank him for coming to earth and giving us this Christmas gift. His love surpasses all gifts, and sacrifice he made because he wanted to be reconciled to us. Wanted to give us eternal life. So we praise him for those who believe in him and receive eternal life. In Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be on his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, the Savior, who gives us peace. Gives us love, and we honor him. So now, let's bring that together with the Old Testament and the New Testament and see how perfectly they fit. You know, the world history. Christmas celebration continue because of the Catholic Church and the Greek Orthodox Church began this tradition. And Christians throughout the world have established Christmas celebrations to spread the good news of victory and looking to Jesus, who is our Christ, our King. And we celebrate. The Old Testament scripture expands on this. All right, then the Lord himself will give you the sign. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. So the Old Testament prophets said to the people, God is going to himself come down. God is going to give you a sign. A virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son, and that son will be called Emmanuel, which means God with us. In the future, in the New Testament, this came true. As he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in the dream and said, Joseph, son of David, he was of the king's family. He said, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. And she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus. For he will save his people from their sins. So, we are saved through Jesus Christ. And so Joseph had this dream that the angel was telling him to take Mary as his wife. And when she gave birth to a child, they were to call him Jesus. And he would give us hope. He would give us a Savior. He would give us peace and joy. Jesus was perfect, but he experienced the sufferings of humanity, our limitations, hunger, illness, tiredness, sadness, so many things that people go through, the darkness and hard times that we go through, pain, we go through loss, and Jesus took all that on. As humanity, he understood our experiences and our suffering. And Jesus had no sin. He was perfect. He was fully God and fully human. He experienced what it's like to be in the flesh, to be tired and hungry, to be in pain, to be tempted. But he gave us healing and love and forgiveness. So now, let's look at the Old Testament versus the New Testament and see how they fit together to show that Jesus is truly the Son of God. And compare the Old Testament in the New Testament. The picture of Jesus in the Old Testament is Moses. In the New Testament we have Jesus. So we can compare the two and see the parallels. It's interesting. Moses and his family, the Hebrew family, he was born, the baby, beautiful baby boy. The Egyptian Pharaoh was angry at the Hebrew people because they were growing so fast. They were slaves, but he was afraid that they would overcome the Egyptians and take over the land, and he wanted to stop them. And so he decided to send the soldiers out to take all the baby boys under the age of two, and throw them in the Nile River, where they hoped the crocodiles would eat them. The Pharaoh didn't care how much they loved their children. He wanted to save his country for himself. He didn't care about slaves. He thought of himself. And it happened that Moses' parents heard of this, and so they decided to make a basket out of wood. And they hid Moses in it. And they put him in the river. And they sent their daughter out to watch the basket. And it happened that Pharaoh's daughter went to the river to bathe. And she noticed this little basket. She sent a slave to go and fetch the basket. And when they opened it, there was the baby inside. And then Moses' sister came and said, "That's my little brother." And she said, "I will take him as my son. Go get your mother to come and be his nursemaid." And so they accepted him into Pharaoh's family and called him Moses. And the name means out of the water. The name Moses means out of the water. So that's interesting. The story has a parallel in the story of Jesus. Jesus, when he was born, shepherds came and worshipped him. The stars, the angels sang to him. What happened? The wise men, the magi came following the star, and they searched for Jesus. And they went to Herod, and they said, "We've seen his star in the east. Where is he? Where is the king that was born?" And Herod said, "This little child is going to become the king. Let me ask my counselors." And so they looked through the Old Testament, and they said, in Bethlehem, where King David was born. And so they told the wise men this. He said, "After you go visit him, come and tell me, and I will go worship him too." And the wise men said, and the wise men agreed to do this, and so they followed the star, and when they got there, they honored Jesus with their gifts. And as they were preparing to go back to see King Herod, an angel came to them and said, "Go back a different way." And Herod waited for the Magi. He waited for a year. And then he called the soldiers finally and said, "Go out and kill all the babies under the age of two, all the baby boys under the age of two. Because I don't want that baby to become king in my place. Go kill all the boys under the age of two." But the angel came to Joseph and Mary and said, go into Egypt, escape into Egypt to be saved. So the parallel of the story of Moses. Moses, even though he was a Hebrew, he saw them being enslaved and being beaten, and he decided to go and kill the soldier who was beating the slave. And then the people thought that he was going to save them, but he fled to the desert for his own safety. And Jesus went and hid out from Herod in Egypt. So Moses stayed in the wilderness until God called him to lead the Hebrews to be delivered from slavery. They'd been in slavery for 400 years, and then Moses led them to freedom. God sent 10 plagues or judgments on Egypt. Because Pharaoh refused to set the Hebrews free. Finally, after the 10th plague, he did let them go free. So Jesus stayed in Egypt until Joseph heard that King Herod was dead. He had 3 sons, and the kingdom was divided between the 3 of them. So because they couldn't get along with each other. And so Joseph took his family back and stayed in the city of Nazareth in northern Palestine. So Jesus grew up there until he was about the age of 30. He was called back into ministry to heal and to counsel and to teach and tell parables until he was arrested and crucified and resurrected and won his victory over sin and over the devil and over death. So he's won the victory. And Moses delivered the Hebrews out of Egypt. He brought them out and delivered them. Another parallel. God sent Moses to lead people into the promised land. He had given them this promised land. And Jesus leads us through the cross and through his resurrection. And now he sits on the throne for eternity. So it's interesting to see the two babies, Moses and Jesus, and the parallels between them. So as we think about the story of Jesus' birth and how he saved us, and Moses, how he saved the Hebrew people, this morning we think about God's gift to us, the great gift was his son whom he sent to the cross to die for us. And when we have Jesus in our lives, he gives us living water. And this is the story of the Samaritan woman. She came to the well, and there she saw Jesus sitting there. And Jesus said to the Samaritan woman, please give me something to drink, some water to drink, I'm thirsty. And the Samaritan woman was surprised. You want me to give you water? But your people, the Jews, and mine, the Samaritans, have always refused to associate with each other. Because the Jews think that they are so holy and perfect and that we are sinners. Jesus said, never mind the culture. I have living water to give you. John 4:10, Jesus answered and said to her, if is the gift of God. Who it is that saith to me, give me to drink, thou wouldest ask of him. Thou wouldest ask of him, and he would have given thee living water. So, ask God for the gift of living water. That means salvation and eternal life. And we can be eternally satisfied and happy to continue to grow in service and relationship to God with the water of life. God doesn't just give it to us once. He continues to pour out living water for eternity. With the Holy Spirit in us. If you believe in Jesus Christ, then you will have living water. If you believe, just as this woman, the Samaritan woman, who had, was a terrible woman, but Jesus didn't look at that. He looked at her heart. Instead of judging her, he wanted to give her the good news of hope, of love. This woman had been promiscuous. She slept with many different men. She worshipped idols. Their religion included the idols of the neighboring countries. The Jews, though, were selfish and deceitful, just like the Samaritans. Their cultures were different, but they were still sinners, just the same. And God counted both sins equal. So Jesus came to give both of them, both cultures, hope and salvation. That's God's gift to us. As Jesus grew up, he had a hard time, but the purpose was so that he could overcome sin and win the victory for us. He sacrificed himself for our lives. Now, this morning, we think about this and the thrill of the Christmas gift of God's Son, who sacrificed his life to come to earth for us. The greatest gift of all. Whatever gift you got for Christmas, you can be happy. It makes you happy, fine, but it won't make you happy for eternity. God sent his Son as the gift that surpasses all else. He gave us the Savior. He gave us forgiveness. He gave us happiness and eternal life. That's his gift. So think about that. If you have not received this gift of God, when you send his Son, take advantage of this time to receive Jesus this morning. He has freedom. He has greater gifts than we will ever get for our family for Christmas. God's gift surpasses all. It has no limits. It's more than we could ever need or ask for. He's happy to give it to us. So if you think about all the things that you need, go ahead and ask God what you need. He'll give it to you. It's a wonderful gift. Amazing. Let's pray. Oh Lord, we pray for the people who are thinking about this great gift. It's not just enough, it's more than that. You sent your Son to die for us. Christmas gift with meaning. Lord, help us to think about this as we share with others. Those who have no Christmas gifts, who are lonely. Those who have family and support pray that you will reach out to them. And remember, remind us that Jesus is the greatest gift. Please comfort children and adults and teenagers who don't have much family, who don't have much for Christmas. Lord, let them know about the good news of Jesus and the greatest gift he has for them. Lord, you've given us the gift of eternal life. I thank you for that gift. This world continues to celebrate and honor you through Christmas. Whether we're number one in the world or number two or three, our life and our culture, we understand Jesus Christ. Help us to continue to remind people of the gospel, to give them hope and a second chance, that it's not too late to give people a chance to change. And we feel like we are stuck and we have failed, we want to give up. God doesn't want us to see us suffer in that way. He wants us to get rid of that negative and accept something positive by learning to reconcile and forgive and apologize so that we can be strong in spirit. Many churches who abuse spirit. Vision hurts. We pray you will heal them and save the people who belong to God. We cry out for our brothers and sisters in Christ to reconcile in this new year. Lord, please give us healing for those who are hurting and those who have given up. Give them a second chance and heal us. Watch over our needs. We want to continue praising you. And we continue to ask you, and you will give. And we continue to fellowship, and you will continue to forgive. Lord, we seek the lost and the scared. Lord, protect them. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.